Ever since he was a young boy, he played the silver ball. From Soho down to Brighton, he must have played them all, but not today, because he's here. He is the lead singer with the loudest and the greatest rock and roll band of them all. The Who. Ladies and gentlemen, Roger Daltrey! Yeah. The rock god has come among us. Have a seat. They are basking in your magnificence, and so am I. It is a real honour to have you here. You see, I want to take you back, if I may, to 1975. I'm in the back of a chemistry lesson. There's me and my mate, Dick Hazard, OK? And we're having the big argument of the time, Led Zepp or The Who.
No competition.
Because, I mean, it would be Dick coming in and be going, have you seen John Bonham? He's ridden a motorbike through the Savoy.
He only copied it off of Keith, though. Keith Moon did it all first.
Well, Keith Moon took the Savoy through a motorbike shop. That was always the great comeback. Keith Moon was the boy. Now, can we just nail a few things down here? Were you ever banned from all Holiday Inns globally?
No. We were banned from a whole state of Holiday Inns.
In America?
In America, yeah.
Yeah.
And because I think Moon blew somebody up in an elevator.
Fantastic. So why did he blow someone up in the lift? Because I suppose he could.
Well, it seemed like the thing to do at the time.
Yeah. Okay, another one I want to nail down. Did anyone from The Who ever drive a Rolls-Royce or indeed any car into a swimming pool?
This is a tricky one, because I actually didn't see it, although I saw the bill, which was substantial. It was $50,000 in 1967.
$50,000?
Yeah, as near as I can get to whether he did or not. He drove a car into everything else if he didn't drive it into a swimming pool. I did see a bill for retrieving a Lincoln Continental out of a swimming pool.
That's the boy.
And the great thing about it was on the second floor.
But it would take a time. Have you seen the restoration films that we're doing, you know, which car? Because Keith Moon's Chrysler's in that.
I know, it's a great car.
Which he drove into a duck pond.
Well, I saw his Rolls in the duck pond, but maybe he put the pair in. I mean, I did see he had a lilac Rolls Royce, because Keith used to have this thing about anything that was for the upper classes, he would get and make it immediately lower class. So he bought a brand new Bentley S2 and hand-painted it lilac.
Right, right.
Not a good finish. And it's that's the first car I think they did the beating up of the vicar trick down Oxford Street, where Viv Stanshaw used to jump out the car at the top of Oxford Street, start walking down Oxford Street dressed as a vicar. Moon would give him 5 minutes start and then draw up alongside, leap out of the car, and beat the shit out of him. in full public view, and just to see the reaction of people.
See, this is the lovely thing that I can count myself in because I was part of that whole generation of The Who, that today with your Maroon 5s and your McFlys, they're not doing that. I mean, it was, you were living the whole rock and roll dream back then.
We were free to do it. Now the accountants and the businessmen run the business. Yeah. I mean, then they didn't know what they were doing. They didn't know what we were doing. But they didn't know that we didn't know what we were doing. So we could do anything.
The thing is, though, is that you made your name, not made your name, making great records, but live act, smashing stuff up, OK? Smashed all the equipment to pieces, which meant you couldn't have been making any money in those early days.
We were getting paid anywhere from 75 to £150 a night, and on average, we were smashing £250 to £300 worth. Unfortunately, it all worked out, and after 4 years, we were still broke, but we managed to hit it really big with Tommy.
But even before Tommy came along, you had a Corvette Stingray.
No, that was after Tommy had made.
Oh, was that after Tommy money? So, are you a bit of a car nut?
Used to be. Yeah, in the old days, I used to love cars, but I mean now, I can take them or leave them. To be honest, I mean, I've been trying to buy a new car. There's nothing out there I really, really say I really, really would like that.
Aston Martin DB9.
Well, I've looked at that, but they've given me a time to get one of 2007.
Roger, trust me on this. I'll get you one tomorrow. For all the pleasure you've given me, I shall ring Aston Martin in the morning and say I'll come round and burn your factory down if Roger Dalton doesn't have a DB9. Because you had an Aston before, didn't you? It's DB4.
Yeah, I had a lovely DB4 in 1966. Really wonderful cream DB4. And I made the mistake of lending it to my mates when I went on tour. We were on a 3-month tour of America, and I said, well, you know, look after the car for me. Yeah, they looked after it. came back off tour, and I get back in this car, and I'm driving it from the airport home. And I thought, this doesn't feel right. And I get out of it, and it was kind of drawn up alongside an Austin 1100. You remember that awful car of those days? And I thought, it's supposed to be a bit longer than an Austin. And what had happened was they'd been gallivanting around town in this car, and they'd followed a coach load of crumpet down the King's Road. And they were all like, saying, look at our car, and waving and all this. And of course, the coach stopped. And my Aston went completely up the rear of this coach. And they couldn't afford to repair it properly. So they did what only any Shepherd's Bush Chiswick guy could do. They chopped the bit that was bent off, not the whole front. just the bit that was bent. They somehow managed to buy a quarter of a front end.
And welded it on.
And then chopped enough off my car so that it would kind of fit, so the wheel just about turned without missing it.
It's him
it
we're talking about, isn't
Nobby,
it? This is Nobby, is the one. He's actually... We brought him along tonight, the man who crashed your ass, and you're still mates with him.
He won't let me drive his car now.
No, well, I'm not surprised. Now, listen, talking of cars, thing is, we know you've wowed the Shea Stadium, you've been a movie star, but obviously this is the pinnacle of your career now. You're here, you're in the Liana. So, who'd like to see Roger's lap?
Yes!
Let's have a look. Good aggressive start. Here we are, first corner, very tricky one, this. Now, actually, the track doesn't look wet, but the Stig tells me it's unbelievably greasy out there.
Very.
Now, wait a minute, through the hammerhead. See how greasy, oh, very greasy. Look at that, it's hardly, there's not much tyre squeal, and it's running wide, you can tell that. Yeah, we'll give you a mild heat.
Terrible.
We'll give you a mildly wet lap. Follow through. That looked flat out. That's good and brave. That's good and brave. Second to last corner, all right. Here it is. This is the one that catches everybody out. How are you doing? Let's have a look.
Hey!
Yes, sick eye. As usual. And last corner, you cut it good and brave. Through Gambon and across the line. Where do you reckon, then?
I don't really care, as long as I beat Whiteley. I mean,
Whiteley?
Yeah, that's all.
Don't worry about that.
I don't care.
Easily beaten Richard Whiteley. Roger Daltrey, you did it in 1 minute 49.7 seconds. And that is... That is quite something, I have to say.
And it was worse today because it wasn't just wet, it was dry bits.
It was greasy.
And greasy bits.
It was very greasy. You can have a mildly moist on that as well. Mildly moist. Well, that's the fastest ever mildly moist lap we've
ever
had.
Mildly
and
moist.
I think I'm right in saying you are officially a pensioner now, aren't you?
No.
Yes.
Oh, come on, give me a break. I've got a bus pass.
You've got a bus pass. You're the fastest person with a bus pass here.
That is pretty good.
Thank you. Well, you've made me a very happy man coming down here today because I am a huge fan of yours, massively big fan, and I'm going to play Who's Next all the way home tonight. I'll make it home in 15 minutes. So thanks very much for coming. Ladies and gentlemen, Roger Daltrey! Yay!